UTV, in regard and in line with the Big Four agenda, would also focus on matters sports. Now, tonight, enacted by Parliament, the Sports Act 2013 is an act that seeks to harness sports development, encourage and promote drug-free sports, provide establishment of sports institutions, facilities, administration and management of sports in the country. Not many sports organizations and federations have successfully complied with the act owing to different challenges. And tonight, our reporter Peter Maura had a sit-down with the former sports commissioner, that is Gordon Oluoch, earlier today, that is, and prepared the following conversation. Let's take a look.
It's a Monday, and here on KUTV, we make sure that we provide you with an in-depth conversation surrounding the sports industry today. We'll be talking about the Sports Act of 2013, which is an act of parliament that was enacted to harness sports development and ensure that we have a smooth running of different sports organizations and even our national and national teams. My name is Peter Maura, and I'm joined on set by the immediate sports commissioner, Bwana Gordon Oluoch, who is not new to Kenyatta University. Bwana Gordon Oluoch, karibu sana KUTV.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Actually, you're not new here.
No, I'm not new here. I've been here, I was a student here, in fact, twice. And when it was first under the University of Nairobi, and later on when it was a fully fledged university, Kenyatta University. And so I'm alumnus, and I'm happy to be here.
I mean, you're not also new in terms of the sports industry. You've been part of the sports industry for a very long time, right. And you understand some of the dynamics. In fact, you're one of the few guys who know how to do the technical part in terms of the sports management. Let's talk about quickly about the Sports Act 2013. From a layman who doesn't understand a lot about it, what is it born to help in terms of running on sports?
Right, sports came as a long journey, as a result of a long journey. And there was the realization within government and realization within the sports stakeholders that there was no particular order in managing sports activities in Kenya. We had, for example, sports organizations which were registered under the Companies Act. We had sports organizations registered as community-based organizations. We had sports organizations registered, the majority of them were registered under the Societies Act. So you see, there were many different areas and players in sports, and this was not bringing about harmony. That was the first one. Number two, there were a lot of wrangles in sports which had to be controlled. Number three, there were inadequate funds, yeah, for running sports, and something had to be done, and an institution had to be created to harness funds which are used to develop sports. So these are some playing environments and circumstances. Another one, the environment, our sports facilities were not good enough to meet the international standards, and an institution had to be created to look into the establishment, yeah, and management of sports facilities. So all these put together brought about, one, the need for having a sports policy in place. Yeah. And when the sports policy came about in 2005, we realized it needed to be anchored in law. And therefore, we started working in earnest to make the act. And it came about, there was the sports bill for a very long time, yeah, with the stakeholders debating on it, the pros and cons of the sports bill. Finally, it was taken to Parliament, and it was enacted, and the President assented to it, and it became the Sports Act. And now that is the act under which sports operates in Kenya.
I love how you mentioned about the harmony, harmonizing, and make sure that we have easy running, whether it's the right national team and right different organizations that are guided by one law and then the same regulations. Yes. I know on March 10, the President promised Kenyans and said that we are not going to be having issues with the national team now that we have the Sports Act. We make sure that everything falls into place and no national team that is not able to participate. Just a quick one from where you stand from. I think we have had different teams that have been able to be given the perfect fundings for their preparation. But again, we have others who have been struggling, but we have the Sports Act. Are we having a situation where we have children of lesser gods?
I don't think so. Everybody in sports is treated equally. And all our national teams, we do appreciate that they've undergone a lot of sacrifice. By the time a player reaches the level when they are playing for the national team, a lot has gone into the preparation of this player, right from the time when the player was a child, maybe growing up into teenage, into adulthood, and so on, and being selected into the senior national team. A lot has gone in there, investment in time, investment in technical aspects, investment in equipment, investment in the facilities and so on that this person has used. And therefore, when they come of age and they represent this country in whatever capacity, they are given due recognition and of course, given the due funds that they require to enable them perform well for the benefit of this country.
Close to 67 federations in the country which are registered or rather which have been running. I know you are a stakeholder and you're the immediate sports commissioner. Some of this question probably, because you're a stakeholder and I think you are better positioned to give us an insight on how the running is or rather how it stands from the ground. Let's talk about that. We have at least 67 federations.
Correct.
But not many have been able to comply the Sports Act of 2013. What is the biggest undoing? What is the biggest struggle? Why are we not being able to see many federations being able to comply?
Right. As I've mentioned earlier, we had sports federations and sports organizations which were registered under different acts. Under the Community Development, others were registered under Companies Act, others were registered under Societies Act. Now, when this was harmonized and the Sports Act came into being in 2013, a very crucial office was created, was among the new institutions which were created. Please allow me maybe just to mention that. There was the Sports Kenya, which was created in order to improve on sports facilities and start nurturing sports talent at the mass level. The Sports Academy was created, the Kenya National Academy of Sports, was created in order to improve on elite sports performance of this country. The Office of the Sports Registrar was created in order to harmonize the registration of sports activities. The Sports Tribunal was created in order to handle all the cases of disputes which were appearing in sports, and every day, one day after another, somebody was going to court over this complaint or another complaint. And now all those things are being handled by the Sports Tribunal. And another thing, institution which was created was the National Sports Fund. Yeah. The National Sports Fund was supposed to generate funds and harness funds for the development of funds, in the realization that the funds which come from the National Treasury, from the Exchequer alone, are not adequate to run all sports activities in the country. And therefore, other money must be created from elsewhere to run sports activities. So the National Sports Fund was created. There are new developments now. The PFM Act 2018 now introduced a new fund, which is called Sports, Arts and Social Development Fund, which has now taken over the responsibility of the National Sports Fund. But coming back to the registration of sports organizations, I've already talked about the establishment of the Sports Registrar's Office, which registers the sports organization. Now, the challenge we are having is that the rules and regulations which were put to guide the registration of sports organizations seem to be too stringent for these sports organizations.
I love that you mentioned about the Sports, Art and Social Development Fund that is supposed to take over the National Sports Fund. I mean, does it mean that the National Sports Fund ceases to exist?
Now, the Sports Fund gets absorbed into the new, bigger and more robust Sports, Arts and Social Development Fund. So the National Sports Fund, as we knew it, as it was created by the Sports Act 2013, now gets consolidated, gets absorbed into that bigger fund. And that bigger fund now is going to be responsible for supporting a lot of activities in the country.
Now, with the incorporation of the art and social development, different social development, it means that maybe they're thinking some of the lesser, or rather the new up and growing sports might miss out when it comes to sharing the cake. Should it be a concern from their side, or rather, is the cake enough for all the facets?
That fear among stakeholders. Everybody likes their industry. And when the sports fund was consolidated with the other with the other, with the arts and with other social matters, there was a little fear in the sports circles that there may be inadequate funds now, because it is shared resources, that the funds may not be adequate for sports development. However, this fear has been allayed because the funds are good enough. The funds are good enough to run sports, go into the arts, and also help the unexpected social issues that may crop up. And therefore, I have all the confidence that the fund is adequate to meet all the requirements of sports.
Schools should be used as the academies that we've been talking about in sports. They should be the schools. We should be able to give them more power, that they can be able to gift us the talent. The talents can be able to be taken through the whole process. From your side, what's your take on the whole conversation about school being converted, or rather being the academies of sports?
Sports has grown by and large through the use of the facilities, the school facilities in the rural areas. So we must find some synergy in the community sports organizations and the management of those schools so that this trend can continue.
I know we've talked about the Sports Act and what it's supposed to change, the transformation supposed to bring the sports in industry, but we know we need the money. We need the money to make everything that is enlisted in the Sports Act a success. But again, as outlined in the Sports Act 2013, the source of the money is collection from lottery, as well as tax levied from Betting and Gaming Act.
Right. I don't think there's a fight as such between the two organizations, government and the betting. They probably just haven't reached a common ground of mutual benefit where they all benefit from each other. Yes, it is true that the sports, the lotteries and so on are really mushrooming. And there have been some concerns in certain quarters that these institutions are, some of them are influencing our children negatively, because the children are now starting to lack that spirit of hard work, because they think that with 20 shillings I can be able to play lottery and I can be able to win millions of shillings and I'll be a rich person and I do not need to go to school. I think the good old-fashioned hard work must still be upheld. It is the way to success. Okay, these days the younger generation say you work hard but you also work smart. I quite agree with that. Right, so that must be upheld. However, there should be some control on who plays the lotteries, when the lotteries are played, how much can be invested in the lotteries, and so on. But we do agree that the lotteries have played a very important part in the economy of the country and in developing some sports. And some of these companies have actually been generous enough to support sports activities, and we in the sports industry want to thank them for that.
You mentioned about the county governments, and sports is a devolved function, but we have not had conversation in terms of sports being a devolved function. Actually, we have not seen a lot happening, as much as maybe compared to the likes of education and even health, how we often talk about how the county plays a role to make sure that the health, they play a role in health. But in sports, we don't get to hear more of this conversation.
You are quite right. What the counties need to do is just to prioritize sport. As a nation, really, we need to do that, not just the counties alone. Even at the national level, we need to give sports a little more priority than we have done in the past. Sports help us to unite the country, to entertain, to provide employment for our young people, and so on. The benefits of sports, to keep fit, to keep away disease, and so on.
Just talk about how the private sector plays a pivotal role in terms of achieving the Sports Act and making sure that we implement everything to the letter.
The private sector is very, very crucial. The Kenyan system, we are very happy to watch English football on TV, and if you realize one thing about English football, and it's the most lucrative right now in the world, if you look at them, all those big teams there are sponsored by certain companies. And because of that, it's a huge industry with a huge turnover of money annually. So the role of the private sector cannot be downplayed as far as sports development is concerned. Even though government gives money from the national treasury, and even though now we are talking about funds, from the national from the national sports, mm-hmm. arts and social development funds, it will still not be adequate for the development of sports, and we must bring on board the corporate sector. Mm-hmm. But the corporate sector also has something to gain. Sports is glamorous. Some of our sports icons are some of the best known faces in Kenya, and they can be used to market your products. You can use them to market your products and improve your visibility, your business visibility, and the consumption of your product. So this is a kind of win-win situation. So we urge the corporate sector to also come on board and support sports activity, and in return they get bigger visibility, they get bigger appeal to the public and bigger acceptability to the public, and become a household name in the country, and that's good for their business. Yeah. So it's not a one-way thing, it's a two-way thing, and we need to work together. And therefore the corporate sector plays a huge, huge part in the development of sports and must also be brought on board.
Excellent conversation, Bwana Gordon Oluoch. Thanks for finding time for us. I think the Sports Act is an excellent idea that we have struggled to comply with, but with time we are going to comply with it, and I'm hoping that it's going to help and change the sports industry. Well, it's been an interesting conversation about the Sports Act for today, but remember, every Monday we make sure that we serve you with interesting conversations around the sports industry. If you just have even a conversation that you would want us to focus on, make sure that you talk to us in our social media platforms, and be sure that every Monday we are going to prepare something for you.